Other 15 nincompoops.
I never watched a beat like that in my life.
Welcome back to the NHL.
It's always good in the NHL when the so-called weaker teams jump up and play some great hockey.
Not a lot of sleep last night, to say the least, and it was good to come out and get the win.
I've said to you before, one of the strengths we've have on our team is some balance.
Get it from the team, only on Leafs TV. MapleLeafs.com for your Leafs online. Meet the players, check their stats and the team standings. Stay on top of everything you want to know about the Maple Leafs. Go back in time with the Leafs interactive timeline and relive Leafs history dating back to the 20s. Or look ahead to the future with the Maple Leafs 5-game outlook. Plus, breaking news, analysis, features, game coverage, and exclusive columns about the team. Even downloadable Toronto Maple Leafs images to customize your desktop. And check out what's on next on Leafs TV. Online, all the time. MapleLeafs.com.
Hi, everyone. I'm Joe Bowen. And it's been my privilege and honor over the last 20 years to broadcast the games of some of the finest athletes ever in the National Hockey League to the world's greatest fans. You, the fans of the Toronto Maple Leafs. You know, the Leafs and the city of Toronto are synonymous, something that can't be said for very many centers around the face of the planet. Over the last 75 years, this franchise has carved out a large piece of our hearts and minds, something that has been very special. Now, we could spend 75 hours talking about the tradition and history of the Toronto Maple Leafs. Instead, we invite you to sit back, enjoy some of the highlights of the men and the teams that have made this tradition, the Toronto Maple Leafs.
Hello, Canada and hockey fans in the United States.
It's great to hear hockey from Foster Hewitt. He just made it sound like you were there.
If we were going to stay in the big league, we'd have to have a new arena.
All the seats teared up, you know. It was a glorious place.
I was hired to work for the Maple Leaf organization, and quite frankly, I thought I had died and gone to heaven.
The Maple Leafs have won the Stanley Cup. Bob Blom lets the drive go score!
If you ever win a Stanley Cup here, boy, that parade that they had for us year after year, I mean, this is a great hockey town.
10 points in a single game is beyond conception. It was a miracle night.
The Toronto Maple Leafs are life in Toronto. People care about their kids and going to church on Sundays and the Toronto Maple Leafs.
Great thrill to be part of the team for the 75th anniversary.
February 13th, 1999, there was one place every hockey player and fan wanted to be. Maple Leaf Gardens. The arena on Church and Carlton had been home to Toronto's beloved Leafs since 1931, and the era was now coming to a close. The team's astounding history of 11 Stanley Cups, dozens of Hall of Famers and fan favorites came together to say goodbye. But to understand what made this night so extraordinary, you have to go back to the beginning. Before there was a Maple Leaf Gardens, there was a man who forever changed the city of Toronto and the hockey world.
In 1927, the St. Pat's owners at the time wanted to sell the team and move out. There's an offer from the city of Philadelphia for $200,000 to buy the team and move them out.
Enter Constantine Falkland Smythe. Smythe angered at being fired by the New York Rangers in 1926, hatched a plan to save hockey in Toronto.
Conn Smythe had come in, said to the owners, says, if you lose the team, it'll be a long time before you get another franchise. So they said to him, well, if you can match the offer, we'll let you have the team.
In February 1927, with help from other investors, Smythe did purchase the St. Pat's. He did, however, make immediate changes.
The owners wanted to capitalize on the large Irish population in the city, so they gave the team an Irish name. And Conn Smythe was a monarchist and a proud Canadian, so he changed the name.
Conn Smythe was a military man, and in the First World War, there was a regiment or a division with a maple leaf insignia on it, and he thought that was appropriate for Canada's team.
A name change and blue and white uniforms gave the team a new look, but it was Smythe's personality that truly altered the franchise.
His word was gospel. If you played for Conn Smythe, you'd better be on your toes at every moment.
He demanded loyalty and demanded perfection and tradition, and if Conn Smythe was not involved originally, the Leafs may have taken a different path.
It was Smythe leading all the way, acting as owner, general manager, and coach early on. And when he signed Harvey Jackson in 1929, pairing him with Charlie Conacher and Joe Primo, the famous Kid Line was born.
The Kid Line, I think, was the first great line, certainly the first great line for the Leafs. Primo was a very classy centerman. Conacher had the booming shot and the big body to go into the corners and get the puck, and Jackson could do it all.
Conacher was a bull on right wing, and normally I had to cover him quite often. And he said one time, he said, you better come in the dressing room. You've been with me all night.
They used to say Joe Primo made the bullets and Charlie and Harvey fired them. They were fantastic.
With a scoring line in place, Smythe set his sights on obtaining a star defenseman. And when word spread that Ottawa was willing to sell top blue liner King Clancy for the hefty sum of $35,000, Conn jumped at the chance in a unique way.
Smythe himself was not a very wealthy man, so he had all of these connections to finance the team. But in order to get King Clancy, all he did was went to the racetrack and bet a ton of money on a horse called Rare Jewel.
Conn Smythe's horse won the first race she ever won, and he bet hard on her. I think he made $11,000, and that helped him accumulate enough money, $35,000, an unheard of sum.
So I got right on that train and went off to Ottawa. Got a hold of Clancy and got him down in the room, and right then and there I knew he was for us, because he didn't sit still. He jumped over the top of the bed and on top of the dressers and all over the place. And I said, I understood, Clancy, that you didn't like Toronto, that you wouldn't play in Toronto. I'll play any place, he says. I'll play any place.
He's one of my idols. I always thought number 7, that's the number he wore, was my number. And when we were thinking of getting married, my wife chose the month and I chose the date. Guess what? The 7th of September.
Courage, character, heart, and devotion. That's what he got with King Clancy.
With Clancy and Captain Hap Day on defense and the Kid Line on the attack, the Leafs were an exciting team to watch, packing the 8,000-seat Mutual Street Arena every game. Smythe wanted to capitalize on the team's growing popularity by building a new arena. But it wasn't a time for expensive endeavors.
It was the start of the Great Depression, you know. And I guess a lot of people thought he was kind of crazy to start such a big project when the world was tight for money.
Smythe and his assistant Frank Selke were still determined to build their dream. So they offered trade union stock in the new building in return for labor. The workers agreed, and Maple Leaf Gardens turned from a dream into reality.
I was fortunate enough to be able to go in the odd time during the construction, and I'd look at this place and look up and see the dome. And
they had to take it out and put it in the Ontario one, and of course I loved that.
The hottest hands in Toronto and the kindest embrace, Machine Gun Lanny McDonald. One of a couple of great treats from Sweden, the King, Boreas Salming. 10 points in a single game. 9 consecutive games with a goal. Your captain, Daryl Sittler.
After the success of the 60s, Toronto fans expected nothing less entering a new decade. And while their arch rivals dominated the championship chase, it was the Leafs who provided some of the 70s' greatest moments, both abroad.
Here's another shot, right by the floor! And he's done it! And scored for Canada!
And at home.
Where are you selling? Pass corners in the field!
Somebody asked me what's the best time when I was here. I mean, it was in the 70s.
Well, we had a team with a lot of grit and a lot of character, and we were very close as a team. They liked the colorfulness of our team, guys like Mike Pommettier, Tiger Williams, Boria, Lanny, myself, Ian Turnbull. There was a good cast of talent and characters.
They have the only goal of the second period. Here's McDonald, a drive, he scores!
He bled blue. He was just tremendous.
Lanny, I mean, he really struggled his first year, but Red stuck with him. Then he put him on a line with Sid, and, you know, the two of them clicked right off the bat, and, you know, they never looked back after that.
Perfect shot by Lanny McDonald.
Now, McDonald was such a fan favorite, a great scorer, a great team man. McDonald was a true Leaf.
They loved Tiger Williams. He always created a fuss out on the ice, always getting into trouble, and always coming up with great quips and comments for the broadcasters. One night we saw Joe Lamatea, the penalty timekeeper, laughing in the penalty box area, and I asked him after the game, why were you laughing? He said, well, Tiger was in here. Now there's a fight on the ice, and four more guys are coming in, and I've got this box with the buttons, and Tiger leaned forward impishly and said, Joe, let me push the buttons on the box. And I slapped him on the wrist, and I said, Tiger, you just sit down there and shut up. And he gave me a wounded look, and he said, Joe, if you're going to talk to me like that, I'm never coming back in here again.
Sittler wins the draw. Boreas Salming still there. It went in and out like that. Well, you have to see yourself.
I had an opportunity to see Boria play before the rest of the Leafs, Team Canada 72. And I came back after the series and said to the guys, we got a good one coming.
Watching Salming in training camp, people saying, this is amazing. This fella's not a rookie.
And Boria just showed so much courage. Courage is the word. I can't think of any other word.
I think we played Philly the second game of the year.
He went after Schultz.
Boria grabbed his sweater by both arms. He was holding on, and Schultz was trying to hit him, but Boria was just too strong for him. He's flailing away, and Boria's just standing there like that, and he's like yelling at Boria, and Boria's just looking at him like, man, you really are a dope, right?
He really led the charge for the Europeans, and if I was a player from Europe, I'd be going up to Boria Salming and I'd shake his hand and say thank you very much.
I can remember walking into the dressing room, and they pointed to my stall at training camp, and there was a 27 hanging there, and I knew the tradition and what 27 meant to the Leaf organization with Frank Mihalovic and his great career, and it was an honor that they gave me that number.
Probably one of the hardest working players I'd ever had the pleasure of being associated with.
If you could see a tape of a game now in which he played, you'd see him. Every shift, Daryl was going, bumping, grinding.
Knocked off his stick by Salming. Picked up by McDonald, they score! Daryl Sittler!
Daryl Sittler added a magic to the Maple Leafs that had been missing for a few years.
And on no night was that magic more apparent than February 7th, 1976. When the Boston Bruins came to town.
Salming trying to cut in, right, and it's got this score! Daryl Sittler!
I don't know why it happened.
Sittler has a break over the line. Put the shot,
you know, the stars were lined up right, and the pucks were going in.
Daryl Sittler! Long pass to McDonald, with Salming, right in, and
he scores! I had 5 assists that night. I don't think nobody remembers. I had 5 assists.
Back into Valakhet. Valakhet to Sittler. He shot the goal! Daryl
at the end of the second period, I remember that quite vividly, where Stan Bodiak, he was the statistician, and he made me aware that the record was 8. I had 7 points at the end of the second. He told me Rocket Richard had 8 points, and that was the record.
Up the center. Pass for Sittler. Sittler getting into the field.
Six goals and four assists by the time Sittler's magical night had ended.
It was incredible, really. I mean, you know, 10 points, wow. I mean, and now that you look back, I mean, it still may never be broken.
Toronto's best opportunity for a cup came in 1978. In the playoff second round, they faced another team looking to become contenders, the New York Islanders.
Well, you know, they had a great club, there's no question about that, and we did too, but we had a younger club.
We had a plan, Roger Nielsen had a plan, just hit everything.
And our young team really didn't know how to handle a lot of that.
Through six games, neither team failed on home ice.
The seventh game in Long Island, nobody gave us a chance, but, you know, we were sitting in the dressing room and Roger said, look, you guys got nothing to lose. I mean, we got the tie. Lanny came in, you know, got in about 35 feet.
Now Turnbull clears it ahead to McDonald. McDonald, he scores!
I looked at Jack Valiquette and I went, Jack, it went in.
McDonald wins it! The Leafs win it!
And then we jumped over the boards. There was pandemonium, right?
Though Montreal would spoil the party, Toronto had enjoyed its greatest success since they celebrated their last Stanley Cup.
We only needed another player or two, and we were going to be a real contender and possibly could have won the cup. And the rest of the league were getting a little concerned about us. But unfortunately, Leaf management decided to make some changes, and that team was basically torn apart within the next 2 years.
If there was one decade in the Leafs' history that Toronto fans would like to forget, it would be the 80s. Gone were many of the faces fans had come to adore, and in their absence, a decade-long spiral.
Picked up by Bobby Smith. Smith moving in. Jams around 1 minute. Oh! Bobby Smith, what a move he put on Palmateer.
Nothing could stem the tide. The franchise that had four general managers in its proud history had four in 10 years. Harold Ballard wanted nothing more than to return the Leafs to glory. But this era would have no happy ending.
We can joke all we want.
They all run. Wait a minute now. I run the club. I pay the bills, so I got a chance to talk, right?
Yes.
All right. Now, what's your question?
When you were a Leaf fan in the 80s, you expected the worst.
The 80s were such a departure from former Leaf decades. I mean, it was so dismal to do Leaf games.
But for such a dark decade, it wasn't all bad.
Shoots!
1985 draft, Wendell Clark comes in.
Clark playing it with Kordick. Stars! Wendell Clark! A bullet! And it's 4-0.
Refreshing. Here's a kid. He's going to knock players into the boards. He can score goals. He's fearless. They loved him in Toronto.
But even Wendell Clark had no cure for what ailed the Leafs.
You would get a great player like Vive come along with a 50-goal season, and then another, and a third, and later on you'd get a Wendell Clark, but they were bereft of other talent, and other coaches and managers made terrible decisions.
Like 1 year, we were out of playoffs, you know, 10 games before the last game. You know, then it was just like, wow, how are we going to keep this up? You know, play for really nothing.
You had to be a hockey fan, not a Leaf fan, because if you were a Leaf fan, you'd be heartbroken.
I was fortunate enough to be able to go in the odd time during the construction, and I'd look at this place and look up and see the dome and all the seats tiered up, you know. I thought it was massive.
That was an incredible feat of engineering, the fact they broke ground in June and opened in November. I mean, nobody would believe that would happen today, but it did. And I know Clancy told me once, he came over to watch the construction ongoing, and he said, there's no way they'll ever fill this place. I mean, we're used to playing before 7,000, 8,000 people. And he said, I don't think they're ever going to fill it.
But on November 12, 1931, over 13,000 fans proved Clancy wrong and packed this beautiful palace.
Jackson and Conacher are skating out there, all ready to go for this historic event where the NHL is starting in Maple Leaf Garden.
The home team lost 2-1 to Chicago, but it was clear that Toronto was home to a new shrine of hockey. Smythe now had everything he wanted, except for a Stanley Cup. Sensing this first year in the Gardens was pivotal, he made a quick coaching change.
4 or 5 games into the season, Conn Smythe decided that his coach, Art Duncan, wasn't doing the job he wanted, and he said, how'd you like to coach the Toronto Maple Leafs? And my dad said, what's wrong with the Maple Leafs? He said, nothing's wrong with the Maple Leafs, but I'm going to change coaches. So he said, well, think about it. And always said, I want you here Saturday night if you're going to take the job. My dad arrived in Toronto on the Saturday morning, and Smythe, the idea was that Smythe was going to coach the team that night in a game against Boston. And my dad would observe and then take over the team the next day. Boston's leading 5-1 in the second period. Smythe turns to my dad and said, you can take over now, Dick, and walked away.
Remarkably, Toronto stormed back and won the game 6-5, giving Dick Irvin his first win. It began an unbelievable stretch that would lead them all the way to the finals, and Smythe's old team, the New York Rangers, Conn, would get the last laugh.
We went in and we won the cup. And I'll tell you, I was ecstatic. Even though the depression was on, that gave us a new life. And this was a hockey town, I'll tell you.
In a few short years, Smythe had indeed made Toronto a hockey town. But it was another man's voice that turned an entire country's attention to the Leafs.
At the time, I was working on CFCA. It was a part-time job. I had finished what I thought my work for the day. And Vassal Lake, the radio editor of the Star, came up to me and said, you have another job tonight. You're going to broadcast the hockey game. Apparently, they had canvassed the entire sports department, and I was the only one left. So I just went over there and did the game.
That break in 1923 was the beginning of a 49-year career for Foster Hewitt. But it wasn't until he moved to his new home atop Maple Leaf Gardens that a legend was born.
The architect and myself went down on Bay Street, and we found that the best height was on the 5th floor. So we adapted that at the gardens to that height. They called it the gondola because an advertising man suggested that it was like the gondola of an airship.
His calls from the gondola turned the home team into Canada's team.
I think Foster Hewitt, the golden voice of hockey, that he's the guy that really put hockey on the map, especially the Maple Leafs.
Foster Hewitt's broadcast, everyone in the city and the country followed the Leafs devoutly.
Score 3-2 from the Toronto Maple Leafs. When they face off, the Leafs shoot the puck wide of the Canadian net.
My dad coached the Leafs. A couple of times they would go after the season was over on what they call barnstorming trips out west. And Foster went on the trips. When it came to the players on the platforms and the railway stations and the autograph seekers there, he was first and foremost. It was Foster Hewitt.
I remember getting a blackboard at Christmas one year, and never mind subtracting and adding numbers and that. I drew 2 goal nets, you know, and started to move, and then I would clean the chalk off and pretend it was the ice. So my imagination got carried away with Foster Hewitt.
Listen to Foster Hewitt, Maple Leaf Garden, the gondola at Maple Leaf Garden. That was just like a religion, and we'd never miss that.
Forward pass, goal loose, it's right in front of the goal.
Not only were future players impacted by Foster, but announcers as well.
I gotta find out where Foster Hewitt's radio station is, and maybe he's there, and maybe I could meet him. He was there, and I did meet him, and we talked for an hour or more. And he listened to a tape I had with me, and he didn't exactly suggest I find another profession, but he was very nice. He pointed out different things and asked me to stay in touch, and he gave me some things to think about. Foster Hewitt was the man.
He shoots, he scores!
10 men whose names appear on the most coveted trophy in sport are here at Maple Leaf Gardens this evening. Pete Langelle is here this evening. So is Harry Watson. Gay Stewart. Donnie Metz. Elwin Morris. Cal Gardner. Bill Juzda.
Toronto's thirst for another sip from the Stanley Cup was growing. The Maple Leafs had six fruitless trips to the finals after the triumph of 1932. And in 1942, they looked to change their fortunes. With Captain Sil Apps leading the way, and a blossoming star in Walter Turk Brode in goal, the Leafs again found themselves playing for the Cup against Detroit. But after three games, it seemed Toronto was destined to lose again.
No one could believe that the Leafs were about to get swept.
Before that game, Hap Day benched star right winger Gordy Drillin and his big defenseman Buckle McDonald, and he inserted a little bit more speed.
In came winger Don Metz and defenseman Ernie Dickens. But perhaps Day's most important piece of coaching happened before his team took the ice.
This little girl at a Toronto school wrote a letter to Coach Happy Day, more or less saying, I'm just so distraught and I can't believe you guys are going to lose tonight, you know, and pleading with the coach and with the players to win one for her, for all of the young loyal fans.
So he read the letter to all the players, and this just got the adrenaline flowing. And as the team was going out on the ice, and Sweeney Schreiner turned around to my dad, he says, "Don't worry, Coach, we're going to win this."
Day pushed all the right buttons. Metz scored the game winner in Game 4, and he added a hat trick in Game 5. Brode, who had surrendered 12 goals in the first three games, yielded just 7 goals over the final four. And behind the two-goal performance of Sweeney Schreiner, the Leafs became the first team in sports to overcome a 3-0 deficit to win a championship. Unrest had fallen upon the world as the 40s unfolded. World War II had erupted. No one was immune to its effects. Conn Smythe, a decorated hero of World War I, would not stand idly by.
Smythe valued loyalty more than anything else, and he valued loyalty in three ways: to king, to country, and to the Toronto Maple Leafs, and in that order. So when it came time for war, he was the first to enlist.
The war stripped many teams of their stars, and the Leafs were hit hard. Players such as Apps, Brode, and Gay Stewart turned in their skates for battle fatigues. And Smythe was loyal to those who served.
He promised any player on his team, at least, who would enlist, that they would be given a fair shot to make the team upon being discharged. So that there was, again, there was a sense of give and take and a sense of loyalty, so that if you enlisted, your career would not be jeopardized.
Ironically, Smythe's role in the war played a large part in one of the Leafs' most important acquisitions, that of Ted Teeter Kennedy. Smythe left Frank Selke in charge of the team with strict instructions that no moves were to be made without his approval. However, Selke was offered Kennedy in a trade. Selke, enamored with Kennedy's talents, made the deal. Smythe was fuming when he learned of the trade, but time proved Selke right.
Conn Smythe said he's the number one Leaf player of all time. Kennedy was a great leader. Great offensive player, made the players around him much better.
Teeter seemed to epitomize to me as a youngster all that was good about the hockey, game of hockey. I think Teeter has been, to those who go that far back, has been one of the greatest Leafs ever. It's everything you'd want someone to be in a hockey player as a person.
Toronto's love affair with Kennedy developed in 1945 as the highest scoring forward led his war depleted team into battle with the regular.
Claimed that was the greatest team, the Montreal team was the greatest team that ever played in the National Hockey League. We won it with two lines, a spare centerman, and four defensemen, and a goalkeeper. We beat them in six games.
Then it was on to Detroit and an epic battle. The Leafs won the first three games. Detroit, looking to avenge the heartbreak of 1942, came storming back to tie the series.
in Game 7, there was, again, you know, this huge pressure on the Leafs because everyone thought, well, now is Detroit going to do to the Leafs what had been done to them 3 years earlier?
Down the ice goes Sweeney Schreiner with a puck, then passes it to Kennedy, who rifles it in the cage to win the Stanley Cup and the championship of the world.
With Broda and Apps back from the war, the Leafs were primed for a run unlike any the league had ever seen. And leading the way was Broda, who was a rock between the pipes. In fact, so strong was Turk, at one point he played every minute of every game for 3 straight years, a feat which may have impressed many, but didn't keep Conn Smythe from benching him.
Broda was always a chunky goalie. Exercise was not a regimen he maintained on a daily basis. And Conn Smythe just sort of blew up and thought, well, this is ridiculous. You weigh 192 pounds and I want you down to 180 before you play your next game. And so he benched him and he cut him off right in the middle of his sort of Iron Man streak and told him he had to lose weight. The benching only lasted one game, but the newspapers just ran with the story like crazy. And day after day, Mrs. Broda would be interviewed in the paper saying, asking her what he ate, what Turk ate today, and what kind of a diet is he on, and what's he eating, and how are the children coping with this, and how are you doing to help him through this tough time.
Turk Broda was the outstanding playoff goalie, tough to beat in the playoffs, and the Leafs had a great defense system, but if Turk Broda would, you know, if you get me one goal, we'll win, and he would tell his teammates that.
And Broda was a favorite of the fans for good reason.
Just at the start of the war, 1940, I had a very serious accident at work, and I got burnt with lime and lost my sight. But when I began to get a bit of sight back, I was in the hospital, and one day the nurse said, there's somebody special to see you here. And he says, do you know me, kid? And I thought, geez, it couldn't be. So I said to him, well, you look like Turk Broda, but Turk wouldn't come to see me. Well, he says, you know, kid, why wouldn't Turk come to see you? He says, I am Turk.
Another key ingredient to Toronto's phenomenal run through the 40s was Sil Apps. The Leafs captain was an all-star 6 times. So respected was he, after serving as a second lieutenant in World War II, he was immediately handed the C upon his return to the team.
And you idolized Sil Apps and was able to get his autograph one day. That was so meaningful to your life. It was something you treasured. And I remember it vividly to this day how Sil Apps put best wishes, Sil Apps, on my autograph. And I told my dad, look, he put 2 extra words on there. Isn't that really great of him? And he was my idol for life after that.
Well, Sil Apps was wearing number 10 and was the captain of the Toronto Maple Leafs. Every kid in Canada wanted to be Sil Apps.
The man who molded the team on the ice was Clarence Hap Day. Regarded as one of the toughest coaches ever to step behind an NHL bench, his training camps were compared to prison camps. He believed the way you practiced was the way you played.
Hap Day was a disciplinarian with a great system and a defensive style of hockey. The players respected him and they played for him.
With all the pieces in place, the Maple Leafs grabbed hold of the cup. In 1947, Toronto dethroned the Canadiens in 6 games.
And here it is, the winning goal. The Maple Leafs cop the coveted trophy, emblematic of World Championship hockey. Toronto fans breathe easy at last.
People in Toronto grabbed a hold of that Leaf team. They'd been wanting desperately for the Leafs to win.
Toronto became the center of the hockey universe. The Maple Leafs were champions and pioneers. To start the following season, Toronto took on the best in the league's first ever All-Star game. Later that year, they acquired Chicago's Max Bentley in a stunning 7-player trade.
Conn Smythe always believed in strength down the center. It was a natural trade. The Leafs needed a top centerman, and the Chicago needed players. The Leafs had Apps, Kennedy, and Bentley as their 3 centermen, and no one could touch them.
With an all-star lineup of its own, Toronto was hockey royalty, and the Leafs were not to be overthrown. They captured the Cup for a second straight year with a sweep of Detroit.
People were just mesmerized by the team. There was a great aura about the club.
And nothing could stop the juggernaut.
Their farm team, I think, could have beat most NHL teams. They were so strong.
They're off to win the Stanley Cup for the third straight year, something no team has been able to accomplish in the trophy's dramatic history.
Toronto did the unthinkable. Another sweep of Detroit and a third straight cup. 3 years had turned the team into a dynasty and players into heroes.
The Maple Leafs were our heroes and our people that we looked up to.
2 years later, Toronto put the exclamation point on an era.
Toronto Maple Leafs versus Montreal Canadiens. This has been one of the hardest fought Stanley Cup series in all hockey history.
The Leafs actually tied the game in the last minute of play with the goalie on the bench, which is kind of neat because people don't often remember that part of the game.
Todd Sloan's goal forced overtime, and Bill Barilko scored one for the ages. Toronto celebrated its fifth cup in 7 years. As the book closed on the league's first true dynasty, the Leafs stood as the standard for all teams aspiring to greatness.
We want to shift our focus now to the 1960s, another grand period in Toronto Maple Leaf history. Four Stanley Cups. It was the time when Foster Hewitt was set to hand over the reins to Bill Hewitt, who could introduce us to a new set of Hewitt.
Here we are at Maple Leaf Gardens in Toronto, all set for the face-off. Now it's the Leafs coming back. The Mahoffman's getting a chance. He shoots. He scores! Flex over to Bathgate again. Bathgate gets that turn of it. Even scores! And the game is over. Jeffrey coming out in front of shot, and Power makes the save.
The Maple Leafs franchise enjoyed a stunning renaissance in the 1960s. But before the rebirth, there were years of struggle.
There was the Barilko winning goal in 51 and then his sad departure from this earth in a plane crash a few weeks later.
Barilko's body went unfound. The Leafs soldiered on despite the tragedy, but it took them years to recover. In the meantime, another dynasty took their place.
Montreal and Detroit were the big rivalry in the early to mid-1950s. But then Punchimlak arrived on the scene here in Toronto.
He was a shrewd motivator with a keen eye for talent.
I've had a lot of coaches, and I think Punch's asset is that he can measure to within 1 ounce a player's ability on a bench.
Immediately, Punchimlak instilled a confidence in his players, and he said, we're going to make the playoffs, and then we're going to win the cup.
We had a group of young players that the Maple Leaf scouts had produced, Bobby Pulford, Bob Bond, Billy Harris, Carl Brewer, Dickie Duff, myself, we came along. So we had a nice mix of the youth with the experience.
When he came to the Maple Leafs, he was sort of the thing that brought us all together.
Inspired, the Leafs made good on the first part of their coach's promise as they made the playoffs.
I said that we'd beat Boston in six, and it took us 7 games to beat Boston. I guess I got mixed up a little. Maybe the crystal ball was a little hazy. It's probably that we'll beat Montreal in six.
However, Toronto would fall to the Canadiens in the finals that year and the next. Though the Leafs were unsuccessful in stopping Montreal's run, they did reignite a rivalry. And Imlach was more driven than ever to win the battle.
Myself, we came along. So we had a nice mix of the youth with the experience.
When he came to the Maple Leafs, he was sort of the thing that brought us all together.
Inspired, the Leafs made good on the first part of their coach's promise as they made the playoffs.
I said that we'd beat Boston in six, and it took us 7 games to beat Boston. I guess I got mixed up a little. Maybe the crystal ball was a little hazy. It's probably that we'll beat Montreal in six.
However, Toronto would fall to the Canadiens in the finals that year and the next. Though the Leafs were unsuccessful in stopping Montreal's run, they did reignite a rivalry. And Imlach was more driven than ever to win the battle. The Leafs continued to grow and change during the early 60s. Stafford Smythe and Harold Ballard took over ownership of the team. And in 1962, Toronto would take on the defending champion Chicago Blackhawks for the Stanley Cup. After four games, the series was a draw. In Game 5, Don Simmons took over for an injured Johnny Bower. Simmons held his own, and the Toronto offense carried the team to victory. The Leafs led the series 3-2 and were now one win away from the Stanley Cup.
We're going back to Chicago now for the sixth game of the series. If Chicago is to retain its hold on the Stanley Cup, then the Blackhawks must win this sixth game.
All set for the faceoff at the Chicago Stadium. And there's no score in this sixth game as Duff loses possession. Howe shoots and scores! Bobby Howe stole the puck from inside of the Leafs goal and fired into the short side. And Bedlam breaks loose from the Chicago Stadium as the Blackhawks go ahead 1-0. All around the Chicago goal. It goes to Mihailovic. Over to Nevin. He shoots and scores! Bobby Nevin, number 11, has tied it up for the Maple Leafs. The tension is mounting here at the Chicago Stadium in this sixth game of the Stanley Cup Finals.
And with time running out in the third period.
Now the Maple Leafs come right back again. Over the line, Armstrong to Horton. Over to Duff. He turns it to the score! Picked up! Found the range from right in front of the net. He just turned around and fired it. And he beat Glenn Hall cleanly on the shot. And that gives the Maple Leafs a 2-1 lead. The Chicago Blackhawks have taken their goalkeeper out using six attackers. Makita keeps it in. Hull Hay out in front of the net. Brewer overskates the puck, knocks it to the side. Hay flips it out in front. Simmons stops it. The game is over. And the Leafs players come pouring over the board to congratulate one another.
The Leafs again stood atop the hockey world.
Mike Mihailovic was at a function after they won the cup, and someone came in and said they found Brocco's body. And they said, this is amazing.
During that time, from 51 to 62, the Leafs never won the cup. And so this sort of mythological story evolved, whereby there was sort of the curse of Barocco's unfound body, which prevented the Leafs from winning the cup.
The curse was broken, and the Leafs' success continued as they defeated the Red Wings the following year to win their second straight cup. In 1964, the Leafs returned to the finals and would again face the Red Wings. This time, Detroit proved to be a formidable opponent. Facing elimination in Game 6, Toronto's hopes dimmed when defenseman Bob Bohn suffered what seemed like a season-ending leg injury.
I asked Dr. Jim Murray, who was our doctor at that time, I said, can I hurt it anymore? And Jim says, I don't think so. And I said, well, can you tape it up and freeze it?
Bohn returned to action in the third period with his leg frozen. The score remained deadlocked, and the game moved into sudden death overtime.
Tim and Alan started the overtime. I come out of the dressing room, and Punch called for Brewer and Douglas to go. And I just said to Kent, you stay, I'll go. Junior Langlois threw the puck blindly up the boards. I had just stepped on the ice, and
Bob Bohn lets it drive, it goes, scores! Bob Bohn let it go, it bounced in front and went into the net. And it's all over, and the series is tied.
Bob, now on your injury, what happened, first of all, to you?
It could be a pinched nerve. This will happen sometimes with a pinched nerve, I guess, similar to what Terry Sawchuk had. And it should be straightened out.
And he found out my leg was broken, and he didn't know it. He knew it was sore, he knew it was hurting and everything, but he came back out.
You know, the game of hockey is such a fast game, and sometimes you don't feel the pain until everything's over. And that's what happened to Bobby.
That was just typical of Bobby Bohn. I mean, it was nothing, he didn't think anything of it.
Bond's goal was an inspiration. The Leafs went on to defeat Detroit in Game 7. And for a second time in franchise history, they captured a third consecutive Stanley Cup. It now looked as if Toronto might steamroll the NHL for the rest of the decade.
Montreal got tougher players like Ferguson and Ted Harris, and they could match the Leafs physically. And Montreal was then beating the Leafs to win their cups in 65 and 66. In 67, the Leafs were given no chance. They had an older team.
And Punch kept adding older players. He got Pronovo and others.
Someone in the media used the term over the hill gang, and it started right from training camp. In 1966, everyone was looking at Imlach and saying, are you insane? How can they possibly endure a 70-game schedule, let alone the playoffs?
But this season was like no other. Canada was celebrating its centennial. An expo would be held in Montreal. This was also the final year of the old six-team NHL, as the league was set to expand the following season.
There was a sense of finality, that this was the last year of hockey as we knew it. Come on, boys, let's stick together for just one more season.
The Leafs finished third in the regular season, and then they had a kind of a miraculous run to the Stanley Cup.
We weren't expected to get by Chicago. Our goaltending was fantastic with Sawchuk and Bauer. We get by Chicago. Now we're up against Montreal, who finished in first place.
There was a special prize involved in 67. You were our centennial year champions, and the Montreal Canadiens counted on doing that. Expo was in Montreal. They wanted to parade the Stanley Cup around Expo.
The rivalry was very, very intense. Imlach and Blake just dominated the scene, and the mainly newspapers in those days would get quotes from those two guys who didn't like each other.
And Punch had plenty to say before the finals began. However, Montreal's Rogie Vachon had all the answers in Game 1 as the Canadiens won 6-2.
They blew us out Game 1, and it just sort of set the scene for the whole series. And our guys just said, we are going to do this, we are going to give it all we have.
And the Leafs did just that. With great goaltending, they set themselves up for a clinching Game 6. With less than a minute left in the game and Toronto leading 2-1, Toe Blake pulled Gump Worsley for an extra attacker. With the face-off deep in Toronto's zone, Imlach put his trust in his veterans one last time.
And in the final minute of the final game, there were the old brigade out on the ice with the empty net at the other end, Armstrong and Kelly and Stanley and the rest.
Stanley moves into Belleville. And Red Kelly gets the puck. Kelly sends Pulford away, and there's Armstrong streaking up the right side. A perfect backhand pass to Armstrong. And the Leaf captain hits the empty net.
It's all over. The Toronto Maple Leafs have won the Stanley Cup. The Leaf players pour over the boards. They pound Armstrong on the back, and they pummel Sawchuk. Keon played outstanding hockey during the playoffs and was awarded the Conn Smythe Trophy.
The victory was perfect. The Leafs proved their critics wrong, becoming the oldest team to win the Cup. They were Canada's centennial champions and the last team to win before the league changed forever. Best of all, they defeated the Montreal Canadiens.
The thing I think a captive of Montreal, they were so sure they were going to win it, they had the Stanley Cup in the Quebec Pavilion of the Expos. And when we won, they had to take it out and put it in the Ontario one.
General managers in its proud history had four in 10 years. Harold Ballard wanted nothing more than to return the Leafs to glory. But this era would have no happy ending.
We can joke all we want.
They all, the people, all around. Wait a minute now.
The people out there.
Wait a minute. Like, I'm talking
right?
too, you know. Wait a minute. I run the club. I pay the bills, so I got a chance to talk, right?
Yes.
All right. Now, what's your question?
When you're a Leaf fan in the 80s, you expected the worst.
The 80s were such a departure from former Leaf decades. I mean, it was so dismal to do Leaf games.
But for such a dark decade, it wasn't all bad.
Shoots. He's got 50.
1985 draft, Wendell Clark comes in. Refreshing. Here's a kid. He's going to knock players into the boards. He can score goals. He's fearless. They loved him in Toronto.
But even Wendell Clark had no cure for what ailed the Leafs.
You would get a great player like Vive come along with a 50-goal season and then another and a third, and later on you'd get a Wendell Clark, but they were bereft of other talent, and other coaches and managers made terrible decisions.
Like one year we were out of playoffs, you know, 10 games before the last game, you know, then it was just like, wow, how are we going to keep this up? You know, play for really nothing.
You had to be a hockey fan, not a Leaf fan, because if you were a Leaf fan, you'd be heartbroken because they were going nowhere.
You, 15,700, represent the fans who've been here for seven decades to cheer on the men in the blue and white in the 1990s. Mike Gartner. Ladies and gentlemen, Mats Sundin.
As the 80s ended, so too did the Leafs' decade-long malaise. Their knight in shining armor would arrive from the West in the person of Cliff Fletcher, one of the game's best GMs. Fletcher had built a powerhouse in Calgary that won the Cup in 89. Now he was eager to try to return Canada's team to prominence.
Toronto's the hockey capital of the world, without a doubt in my mind, and the buzz that goes on there on an ongoing basis, and the interest in the team is just tremendous. So when I had an opportunity to go there, I just couldn't walk away from it.
Cliff Fletcher came in, and I've always admired him as a manager in the league. I had watched him put together a pretty good team when I was coaching and managing in Vancouver. So when the Leafs got him, I knew that they had a guy who knew how to put a team together and maybe resurrect the franchise.
After just 6 months at the Leafs' helm, Fletcher engineered the largest trade in NHL history, a 10-player blockbuster with his former team.
It was one of the most unique trades ever made, in that I was only a couple months removed from Calgary, and I probably knew more about the players I was acquiring than the players I was giving up, who had only been with for a couple of months.
One player in the deal would eventually succeed beyond the Maple Leafs' wildest dreams.
I was in Calgary, New Year's Day, and they called me and said I was traded to Toronto. And, you know, there's not too many times that you jump up and down when you get traded. So I was excited about the situation and obviously the possibilities.
Shortly after arriving from Calgary, Doug Gilmore was Mr. Maple Leaf and grabbed this team by the throat and led them to some very enjoyable spots.
While Gilmore injected heart and soul into the Leafs on the ice, Pat Burns called the shots behind the bench. Toronto would go on to face the powerful Detroit Red Wings in the playoffs' first round. The Leafs battled Detroit to a standstill through six games, but winning a seventh game at Joe Louis Arena was still a formidable task.
Going into Game 7 there, I don't even think our families were so sure we had a chance to win that game.
Seventh game going back in their building, and we were down, and we ended up scoring in the last minute, taking it into overtime.
Can you believe it? We are going to overtime. Oh, my heavens. Puck shoving it to the corner. Out front again, Rouse. In overtime, this has been an unbelievable turn of events.
That was one of the crowning touches in Toronto, and that really put the franchise back on the map and brought back the credibility it had been missing for a few seasons.
Maple Leaf fever gripped the city for the first time in years. And against St. Louis, Doug Gilmore weaved more magic in the second overtime of Game 2.
Gilmore back in the net.
I got kind of set up behind the net and really didn't know which way to go. Made a circle move, and Vanderchuk was at the side. Borshevsky was in front of the net.
Around the net, waiting. Gilmore! Solo!
reason it got through there. And again, it was exciting times that whole that playoff run.
Is there any stop to the drama that this Maple Leaf team keeps coming up with?
That was unbelievable. It was just something that the whole city was caught up in every game. It was very exciting to play in that time.
The euphoria would last all the way to Game 7 of the Western Conference Finals, when the pride of Brantford, Ontario, ended the joyride. Despite the disappointment, the franchise had enjoyed its finest hour in recent memory. Pat Burns captured Coach of the Year honors, and Doug Gilmore took home the Selke Award. The blue and white were once again a force to be reckoned with. By the mid-90s, Steve Stavro had become the majority owner of the Maple Leafs, bringing stability to the franchise. The club was also in transition on the ice. Fan favorite Wendell Clark was traded to Quebec for Matt Sundin, giving the Leafs the young superstar they needed.
If you were to put together a player and you had the ability to choose all the assets that a player could have, whether it be size, speed, scoring ability, touch, he has it all.
Matt Sundin wins it for the Maple Leafs!
And he's a leader.
The puck goes over this side, I move out, you come back down.
He can make something happen out of nothing near every shift.
When Sundin seemed primed to become the NHL's first European captain in 1997, he sought the advice of his boyhood idol, Börje Salming.
Well, he I think it was in the summer, he was talking to me.
I knew I was going to maybe get asked, and I remember asking Börje, and he said,
just take it, because it's the best you can do.
He got asked to be the captain for Toronto Maple Leafs, and he wasn't sure, and he ended up saying no.
For myself, I think it was the language and all kinds of stuff. I was in the dressing room and on the ice, I was probably the captain anyways, when there was gone.
He said, for sure you should say yes, it's a great honor, it's something you should definitely do.
But even Sundin's magic was not enough on its own. When Ken Dryden became the club's new president and acting GM, he knew more moves had to be made. First, he installed Pat Quinn, a former Leaf, as head coach in June of 98. But his most brilliant stroke came when Curtis Joseph donned the blue and white.
Shot stopped by Joseph! Pierre stopped by Joseph!
He's a highlight reel goalie.
Another chance! Holy Toledo! What is he doing down there?
He's got incredible instinct and incredible skill, and is the most valuable player on the Leafs.
We became very good friends, and I think part of my job and the reason I stayed here for an extra year was I was able to drive him into the rink every day, and he would get here on time, and I thought that would continue my career for years to come, because I honestly think that Cujo had never driven to the rink.
That drive to the rink was about to change. Stavro and his partners had reached an agreement to purchase the Toronto Raptors and the Air Canada Centre. The Leafs' new home meant the last of hockey's great palaces would be no more.
When you go out west, you realize how big it is to people out there. They never are going to get here, and they talk about it, their kids talk about it. It's the shrine.
So I think they have the right when they say Memoriam dreams are definitely forever, and you'll never replace a building like the Gardens. It's definitely more than just an arena. It's a hockey shrine.
The day had finally come. After 68 years, the grand old lady on Carlton Street had one curtain call left. But its legacy would live forever.
My first time to walk in and look up and see the massive size of this place, I had never imagined that it looked like it did. And it was quite impressive. I spent the whole practice missing all the drills, I'm sure, and looking around the building.
I sat in the greens and watched the game and was just absolutely in awe, not only just about the game itself, but getting off the subway and walking up Carlton Street, and just that the whole event was just so special.
Playing at Maple Leaf Gardens was making it. I mean, that's what we grew up believing. I mean, that was the local arena, the local team. If you really make the NHL, you play at Maple Leaf Gardens.
And so they came from all across Canada to bid farewell, to salute their beloved Leafs, present and past, and to capture an indelible image for their own personal scrapbook.
As a hockey fan, I saw some of the greats that I grew up watching, and being involved with something that meant so much to them was more of a thrill for me. It's something I think I'll appreciate in the years to come.
The teams that had won the four Stanley Cups, I remember Red Kelly and Eddie Shack and all those guys, that they were all sitting across there, and I thought, what an era. There was a lot of emotion. I remember Tagger was crying, and we were part of it, and it was nice to be there.
It was just really almost surreal to see the legends of the Maple Leafs with the current group of players, and to see the current guys enjoying the festivities was just a real treat as well, because I think it showed what it meant to be a Maple Leaf all in one night.
Fans, take this flag to our new home, but always remember us.
From 60 Carlton to 40 Bay Street, the end of one era, but the promising beginning to another.
The stunning new Air Canada Centre was ready to welcome Toronto's favorite sons. And thanks to Stavro and the rest of Maple Leafs management, the future would not proceed without paying homage to the glorious past.
I give a lot of credit to our ownership. You know, there was a conscious effort to build this building in an intimate atmosphere with the new amenities that many of the new buildings have, and to try and bring as many of the traditions from the gardens down to the Air Canada Centre. We hung literally hundreds of pictures. We brought new banners down to the Air Canada Centre. I think this building is as good a hockey building as I've been in, a lot more comfortable for our fans, and I think very few people don't love this building.
This is the best dressing room in the National Hockey League right here, and I can honestly say that. New building or not?
And they've got about 15 bikes, a couple Stairmasters, and all the best equipment.
This is Glenn Healy's weight set, which he works out with every day.
And they also have a thing here for tie, for height. See, it's set right at his height, 3'6".
This is where Heal's worked out for the last 3 weeks. Every time he goes in there, it overflows. Best trainer in National Hockey League, right here, Brian Papineau.
Oh, yeah.
He puts all the holes in Heal's gloves that Heal says he always has, but This is a big part of our square footage. I got to show you back here. Come on.
Well, the whole dressing room facility is 10,000 square feet. 8,000 square feet is for Brian Papineau, just to put all our extra equipment in. And he's got it all lined up here. This is the nuts and bolts of the hockey dressing room. Welcome to our new home.
Welcome and enjoy. It's the best building in the league. No doubt about it.
And the Leafs made opening night at the ACC one of its many memorable moments.
They got it out fast, home down the wing. Pass in front, they score! Thomas, set up by Cohn, and the Maple Leafs have won the game in overtime. Welcome to the city of Toronto, located in Ontario, Canada. Toronto hosted the first ever NHL All-Star Game back in 1947. And this afternoon, the game returns for the first All-Star Game of the new millennium and the 50th All-Star Game in league history. This is the spectacular Air Canada Centre, home of the NHL's Toronto Maple Leafs and the home of the 2000 NHL All-Star Game.
Since this building opened last February, it has become a very happy spot for the Leafs to play.
So it's a very good transition for us. I know a lot of teams have struggled coming into their new buildings, but Air Canada Centre has been good to us so far.
Having firmly re-established themselves as one of hockey's top teams, the Leafs could now let their Stanley Cup imaginations run wild.
People will go bananas here in Toronto, and it'll be a great place to win a championship, that's for sure, is here in Toronto. They'd love to have a winning team here again, and hopefully we can do that.
I can imagine what the city would be like the last time
Toronto won a Stanley Cup was in 67. It's been a long time for us to win the Cup. It'd be the pinnacle. This town will just go hockey crazy.
Oh, she's Toronto go crazy. I mean, if you see Colorado go crazy, when I hear it, I think they probably put the whole city upside down.
There were a lot of Stanley Cups in the past, and we haven't had that experience for a while. So to be involved with bringing another one back would be just an outstanding joy. I feel like it's deserved, it's ready, it's time, and I hope I can be part of it.
Today's Leafs carry 75 years of tradition into every game. The players, the building, even the uniform may have changed, but the bond between the team and the people is forever.
There's no better hockey fan than a Toronto Maple Leaf fan.
It is not inappropriate to say that if there is one center of the hockey world, it is here in Toronto.
I guess you would try to equate it to the Dallas Cowboys, to Dallas, the New York Yankees, to New York. Those are sort of America's team. Well, I think the Maple Leafs are Canada's team.
Well, Toronto's a very unique city. I mean, people eat, sleep, and breathe hockey.
I mean, if I go to a barber shop and it takes a half an hour to get a haircut, well, we talk about 5 minutes on politics and 25 minutes on hockey.
With the Maple Leafs, every day it seems like it's like a 12-month beat. There may not be a story that you think was newsworthy, but the media would be here covering practice with the same fervor as a playoff game in another city.
Just coming home with that jersey you were drafted in, you know, growing up playing them and pretending you're them, and then finally getting to put on a jersey with your own name on it and the big Leaf crest on the front, it's just sends a shiver up and down your spine.
People just support that team, and they play blue and white.
When you talk to players that have come from other teams, when you talk to guys that weren't born in Toronto and they come here, you realize that it's a lifetime experience, and you're not going to experience it in any other city you go to play in.
Long rink-wide feed for McGillie, cutting to the middle! Shot blocked, rebound, goal! Cross, once again!
It's the only town where if you give a half-decent effort, even if you play 50 games, 20 years from now they'll remember. Like, it's an amazing city.
The Toronto Maple Leafs are life in Toronto. People care about their kids and going to church on Sundays and the Toronto Maple Leafs.
The Maple Leafs are going to the Final Four!
Thomas the other way, breaking free. Steve Thomas in!
I think I'm a player that enjoys playing when the pressure's on, and I think that's something that's going to help my game.
Thomas to the line with Sundin trailing. Sundin steps to the middle, scores!
Having a number seven with McDonald hanging up in my rec room, now I can put a number seven Roberts beside it.
He scores! Holy Mackinac!
People can't get enough of the Toronto Maple Leafs.